Each year, Microsoft Research hosts hundreds of influential speakers from around the world, including leading scientists, renowned experts in technology, book authors, and leading academics, and makes videos of these lectures freely available.
Let's get started. My name's Randy Guthrie. I'm an academic evangelist. Happy to be the session chair today. Our first talk will be Marty Humphrey from the University of Virginia, and he's going to talk on using cloud model and using the cloud to model and manage large watershed systems. And since he's already presented today, hopefully most of you already know who he is. So without further ado, we'll turn it over to Marty.
Okay. So the intent all along was that John Goodall was going to give this talk, and he had to unfortunately cancel at the last moment. The nature of this talk is I'm going to describe something that we're just kicking off, just like a number of the projects that we just heard from. We're going to be using Azure to model watershed systems. What I propose to do is talk about this, and I'm not a hydrologist. This is a domain science number two that I don't know much about that I'm yet giving a talk about. And so at the end, I'll put up those MPI numbers again because I zipped through them too quickly in case you're curious about the MPI numbers. So watershed. Watershed is incredibly important to the environment. We have a couple of examples here. Mississippi River watershed, I'm a computer scientist, I'll use computer science terms. The nature of the watershed is to figure out where the water goes, right? And so we're gonna hopefully study something that big, but that's huge. No one can really do that right now. Somewhat smaller, but critically important both to the US, to the world. John is from South Carolina. I'm from Virginia, so we're particularly interested in the Chesapeake Bay watershed as well. Much smaller, but this one is still too big, essentially, for us to really computationally model and run, and I'll explain why as we go along. So instead of being able to really model and measure these very large systems to really get a more holistic view of what's going on, the practical limits these days tend to be on the size of what is shown here, the Eno River near Durham, North Carolina. This is something that is reasonably modeled today on laptop systems, which is what hydrologists really want to use. And so that's as big as is really practical right now. So that naturally sets up what we're trying to do. Can we essentially use the cloud to do things bigger, do things at a finer granularity? Can the dynamic availability of resources in a cloud environment, can we really leverage that to understand what's going on in the environment and make better political and environmental decisions based on it? To give you a little more idea of the numbers, Eno is 66 square miles, which is the one that again, it's kind of the limit of reasonable practicality right now. The Chesapeake is about 1,000 times bigger than that. So if we can essentially do something on our desktop for an hour, going from Eno to Chesapeake is really not that feasible as well. Mississippi is about 20,000 times larger than the Eno. Now, so it is also not clear, because no one has really feasibly been able to do this, it is also not clear what that scaling is. It's not a trivially linear scaling as well. In other words, I asked John, what do we really need computational to be able to go up to Mississippi, which is 20,000 times bigger than what we can do right now? And he says the community really doesn't know. So a little more background on how our project is going to do this. There are a number of community-driven or government-sponsored watershed models. The one that John is most familiar with and has a good impact in the community is the USDA's model called SWOT. SWOT models a number of different phenomena within the watershed. We're going to particularly focus on the flow of water. Other aspects of the model that could be used include, for example, modeling toxins, where they go and how to dissipate them. We're essentially going to be looking at the flow of water itself. Where does the water go after it rains? The nature of the SWOT model is shown here. Architecturally and internally, SWOT is implemented like this. It's divided into a number of different components. The components are semi-independent. It's a modular implementation. Constructing a particular model of a watershed based on the SWOT model involves describing the physics of the environment in terms of these structures. Now, so if you step back for a second, the way that this is done it involves three steps. First one is data preparation. Second one is the model calibration, and the third one is to actually scale it to the appropriate size. The data preparation, there's a similar story, and in fact, this is what we leveraged in the NSF proposal, is a similar story to what I described earlier with the processing of the MODIS satellite data. The data exists in a particular form. It might exist in various different sites, different structures. And so there's a pre-processing stage of the data itself. That is fundamentally not intellectually difficult, but it's very tedious. It's exactly the type of thing that you as a human don't want to be involved with. You can automate everything. And so part of the project that we're going to look into is how do you get these transformations? How do you specify them? How do you fire them such that they execute in Azure, transfer everything as necessary, apply, transfer from the external data sites, apply the necessary transformations via a SWOT or an ARC-SWOT model, and then how do you store that in the blob storage, and how do you potentially share that? So our first step is going to be in automating some of the data preparation, which could take many days on an ordinary laptop, and we really want to significantly speed that up. Second step involves model calibration. What that entails is after you define the model, it's necessary to run it against existing observations over a finite set of time and incrementally modifying your model such that it lines up against your observed observations. That's the nature of calibration. That is, from my perspective, a capacity story. We really need a lot of cycles, convenient, and that's what we plan to use Azure for, and I'll talk about toward the end of the talk some results of how we're doing that already. And then finally, as I mentioned, we want to scale to a particular size, and I'll mention a few things about how we plan to do that as we go along. So to be a little more specific, we have an example that we're currently working with. We have a hypothetical hydrologist named Lucy, and she wants to model the Eno River Basin using the SWOT model from the USDA. We mentioned that our first task is to perform the pre-processing. The nature of that is a collection of a number of different data elements. For example, digital elevation models, land use data sets, and digital soil surveys. This is at different scales and different formats. We have to locate the data, pull it in, and put it all into a form that SWOT is ready to be engaged on the particular data. The way that it's done now is, as I mentioned, very tedious on the desktop. It involves using a tool such as ARC-SWOT or EPA basins to download and reproject the data. And as I mentioned, this tends to be very time-consuming and just not necessary for the hydrologist to be involved. And we're going to look at moving this in an architecture similar to what we've been doing on the MODIS data that I talked about earlier. We're going to set up a web-facing interface for specifying which data is to be collected. This will create an existence of a number of different independent jobs that pull from the data sources. This diagram is from our earlier talk, but it's a similar style. And so we're looking to first apply our data transformation pipeline to the particular SWOT modeling in here, and then, of course, to genericize the whole workflow pipeline and make it available for general data pre-processing on something like Azure. This is a architectural diagram from what I showed earlier. It's a similar type of situation. We're going to probably architect it initially this way and probably move to a more Windows HPC environment, which I'll show in a moment. So after the data is processed, then the next step is Lucy wants to calibrate the model. This is an example of how the model's parameters are changed to match the observed environmental characteristics of the particular watershed being considered. On the left, you can see as we go across time, what should be happening, and I think it does happen in this particular case, is that the green line should be moving as it is calibrated. It should be moving to match the measured observations from the environment. And this itself, the process by which this is done is to execute the model, observe the matching between the real phenomena and what the model predicts, adjust the parameters, rerun the model, and keep doing this in an iterative fashion until it converges to an acceptable tolerance. This itself could take, John was telling me, a number of thousands of runs to do, and each run could take a day. And so the calibration is not to the current state that the community would like. And this is one way in which we're trying to leverage the capacity of Azure to be able to do this. I mentioned that it takes a day for the watershed, and so I think I've covered this. So our current status for the project, we just kicked it off about a month ago, 2 months ago, and we've been leveraging the two projects, this one and the one that I mentioned, combining the efforts to converge on some testing apparatus. And so what we've done is we've created the ability to upload a particular SWOT model. We've then had the ability to add any number of parameters within the model, and for each parameter, create a range by which to modify the parameters. In some sense, this is a very intuitive, not very interesting interface. It does generate what we call a parameter sweep. And the goal here is to actually just make it as simple as possible, as you can imagine. The architecture we've implemented so far leverages, again, what I was talking about earlier with our experience with the Windows HPC environment. And so what's shown on the left is the user submitting the particular parameter sweep to the back-end HPC cluster environment. So this is going to be running on the head node. It's going to be submitting to the head node, and it's going to be creating a number of independent SWOT jobs. We're going to opportunistically run within the enterprise in our HPC Windows cluster. We're also going to expand out to the Azure capabilities as necessary. So when I was talking earlier, I said that I implied that there are a lot of open issues about when exactly is the best situation. When do you want to send it out to Azure, and when do you not want to do that? And one of the things I was implying was the I/O behavior of the application is very much a determinant of when that makes sense or not. We believe the same thing here. This is going to give us another data point at which to determine what are the best situations for when to go to Azure and when to stay within the enterprise. After the user submits, we have a separate pane on the submission which the user engages to determine the status of the SWOT, the watershed models. This is, again, in the calibration stage. What this is showing here is from 2 hours ago. We've submitted a number of SWOT independent jobs where we varied each job is different based on a particular setting of a particular variable. Some of this is sort of debugging, specifying where it comes, where it begins execution, where it ends execution, and the time as well. Most important thing for the end user are the hyperlinks for the results. And so what is shown here is the ability for the user to monitor the execution of the calibration, and then still via the browser interface, click on the zip file that contains the collection of results from the execution of the model. We're currently working with one of John's graduate students in particular to determine if this is really, you know, the best interface. As a computer scientist, I find it hard to believe that the hydrologist wants to sort through a collection of zip files, but he tells me that that's the way they want it. I would personally rather, you know, graphically visualize something, makes it a little more intuitive to sort through. But I don't know if that just doesn't make sense for him, or if he didn't realize that he could do that. And so we're still working on the whole UI aspects of how to get this thing going. But with the basic calibration with the back end, Azure is working right now, and it didn't really take us that much time to do it. Just some quick numbers. Not very much to make of these numbers. We haven't really particularly analyzed it. But this particular model of the Eno watershed that John's graduate student has been looking at, this one that he gave us as a test case runs for 55 seconds on his desktop. Within our cluster environment, it would actually run for 65 seconds, which includes 5 seconds for the staging in. What I mean from that perspective is it includes the time to submit from the browser and retrieve the input zip file from the hydrologist desktop to our server, and that's where the 5 seconds comes from. And if we actually execute in Azure, we get a much better execution time, which again is consistent with our earlier results that the Azure nodes are pretty good compute-wise. I think they're better than advertised with regard to compute capacity. Stage in, the 53 seconds is, we're still trying to figure out exactly where the bottlenecks are for that. So this sort of breakdown, again, doesn't really give us an obvious indication of whether or not we should always run to Azure, whether or not we should always run within the enterprise, and so we're still sort of sorting things out. So I probably should have included this earlier, but the nature of the particular model we're running is that it doesn't actually have very much input data. The computation itself, it doesn't take very much time as well. But this type of application is not obviously not doable in a cloud bursting situation. To continue with the running example of how we plan to, some of the goals we're trying to accomplish in the project are, what we've shown what I've shown right now is that the ability to calibrate a small model. We have the moving parts within Azure to be able to do this. And so now what the scientist Lucy would probably want to do is attempt to scale to a much bigger size. And so what Lucy might next look at is something like an encompassing watershed outside of Eno, where she is currently looking. This next progression would be about 85 times bigger than the current watershed. So that's probably what we're going to do next. Again, we're not sure the storage requirements or the compute requirements. That 85 times is not an indication of computation, but rather the actual landmass itself. And so after, as we go to something like Eno, beyond Eno is getting to a size that it does not make sense to run a model of single-threaded. And so what we plan to do, which hasn't been done to date that we're aware of, is spatially decompose the environment, figure out how the regions of the watershed that we're modeling would interact with each other, and structure the whole job such that they are not as independent as they were. Synchronization is going to be an issue as well. In other words, once we get the calibration of a small watershed working, then naturally we want to scale up. And we probably will structure it such that it is spatially decomposed, and we're going to use a very large number of Azure instances to be able to process and model something of this size. So as we get into this, I mentioned we're only about a month into this. It's a two-year project. As we get into it, we anticipate a number of problems specific to what we're trying to do here. I mentioned Azure only or cloud bursting is not obvious at this point. What are the properties of the application we're attempting to run, which would define whether or not we actually just only run it in Azure or we do a cloud bursting model as well? Within Azure, it's not clear what storage mechanisms are most appropriate for what information. Clearly, the pre-processed information, the output of the pre-processed phase, should reside in blob storage. But for example, we're not clear at this point. We don't have a clear understanding of what is the policy by which to share amongst users, share between instances of the same application at different times. We clearly want to reuse, we just don't know how to do that right now. Similarly, I mentioned that the task granularity and how to structure the application is going to be a big issue for us. In other words, we have a huge capacity within the cloud. How to structure it such that it works in the Azure environment is going to be a big issue for us. How do we synchronize between the individual activities of computation is not obvious as well. MPI is feasible. We don't know if that's what we're going to do at this moment. So we have a number of issues that we're going to have to address in order to really get up into the scale that really matters to a larger environmental impact. So in summary, we're pretty early on. We have the plumbing to perform the calibration. You know, John was talking about this one particular use case he's really interested in, which is he teaches a class, and he's told me numerous times how he gets to a point in the class where he would like the students to be able to write in class, fire off a calibration of a particular model, and then have that available right now. Given the impracticality of doing that on a student's desktop, you know, he sort of cuts that out completely from the course. And so he's really looking at, in the fall, to really use this as a mechanism by which in the classroom to just say, okay, go, and then wait a couple minutes, and then the students would get the effects of the calibration back really quickly. He's really looking to use that as soon as we can, you know, really deliver it for him. And so we have a number of things that we're going to look at in order to scale up as well. And so that's the Watershed talk. And so I felt like I put these up and I didn't get a chance to explain it. So this has nothing to do with the Watershed. But I figured you might like to see it, and I'll give you just a couple seconds and I'll describe it. So what you're looking at is the Azure Cloud Bursting Beta 2 that came out in May gives you the ability to run MPI like that on Azure, but again, it's not optimized for Azure. In other words, the VMs are not going to be placed next to each other necessarily. So we wanted to see what performance we got out of MPI. We didn't write the MPI, right? Microsoft did. Now, what you want to look at, I think, are the bands of the dark blue bands and then the light blue rows. Dark blue rows and the light blue rows. UVA intra local node is latency and max bandwidth when I'm staying within my lousy little nodes within my enterprise. Okay, so I get about 1 minute, 1.19 microseconds. And you can compare that against the comparable activities within the Azure nodes of the same size. Okay, you'll see that the latency is pretty good within an Azure node. And of course, this includes the virtualization layer. Similarly, bandwidth. This is the maximum bandwidth I can get between any two MPI instances. UVA intra-local node is on one of my dual quad cores. If I fire up two MPIs and I blast as much information at them, maximum bandwidth I get is 629. Similarly, on an Azure medium, maximum bandwidth is 3355. The UVA inter-local node is MPI across two nodes in my cluster. Okay? So I think you look at this and say latency is pretty good and bandwidth is pretty good within Azure. This one is the broadcast story. The way you read this one is first, if I do four nodes with four MPI instances within my dual quad core on one box, broadcast latency of 2 bytes is 2.56 microseconds. For eight instances, it's 4.21. The colors are meant to match roughly the same number of MPI nodes. For example, on the purple, if I had a 32-way MPI computation and I'm doing a broadcast, what is the duration? And if you look purple, you see if I do four extra large versus eight large versus 16 mediums. These are my latencies. And on some of these, I put the range of max value to min value, or min value to max value. Okay? And so I think you look at this, and understandably, once you leave a particular Azure node, broadcast is not so good. But if someone wants to tell me a different interpretation for these numbers, I'm all ears. Okay, please stop now. I will.
Okay, thank you, Marty. Do we have any questions?
Yeah, at the beginning of the talk, you mentioned some ArcGIS product that was used in the processing before.
Yeah.
Can you mention other tools that typically the scientist would use? I suppose MATLAB or things like this, and how much interest would there be for these tools to be available within the cloud, Azure? So ArcGIS, MATLAB, maybe other things.
Right. Okay. So ArcGIS. Okay. Here's my lame answer. ArcGIS. I'm a computer scientist. I don't know the importance of ArcGIS. If John were here, that'd be an awesome question for John to answer. John tells me ArcGIS is really important. John also tells me that he has not personally looked into the licensing issues of ArcGIS. I don't know if it would trivially be allowed to run in Azure or not. I don't know. MATLAB, I have a different answer, although it's not that much smarter. MATLAB, nature of the way we use MATLAB in the previous is that we compile, which allows us to run anywhere. We have found that we can install the MATLAB runtime trivially. And so MATLAB, I think, via the compiled nature of it, I think anyone can run MATLAB pretty easily in Azure, pretty much without our help or with anyone else. So MATLAB, I think, is really there for you if you want it. ArcGIS and similar type things, probably more complicated because of licensing.
Okay, we don't have any more questions right now. We'll thank Marty for his presentation and get set up for the next one. Thank take your badge off there. And this can just hang off a belt or drop in a pocket, either one.
Yeah, I'll put it on that.
When I go back upstairs and put the screen on, your mic will be live.
So here's the...
forward and backward.
Oh, forward and backward. Okay, thank you.
Give me just a moment.
No problem.
All right, our next speaker is Dr. Help me out again.
Zhengchang.
Zhengchang Chen Su from the University of Northern Carolina at Charlotte. And he'll be talking about large-scale prediction of transcription factor binding sites for gene regulation using cloud computing. Thank you.
Yeah, so what's the transcription factor binding site? So. For those of you who are not familiar with biology, I think I'll have some slides for you for that. So here's the outline of my talk. I'm going to first introduce the problem. What is the larger scale? What is the binding site? And what is the larger scale prediction binding site in the genomes? And a algorithm we recently developed to solve this problem. And our recent efforts to parallelize this algorithm on a local a cluster. And finally, I will touch about our attempts to put this algorithm on the Windows Azure platform as a result of a recent NSF fund and the Microsoft competition time support. So for those of you who are not familiar with biology, the bacterial genome is usually made by a circular double helix DNA. And in this strange DNA, if we extend it in a linear fashion, there are two types of sequence. The two types of, I should say, functional sequence exist there. One is a coding sequence. Basically, this sequence, they specify the components, that should be exist in the cell. And this and the interaction of these components will make all kinds of biological functions of the cell. So they are they're kind of like the part list. And the second type of sequence, they exist in the what is so-called indigenic sequences. That's the bit that's specifically that's the sequence between the two adjacent genes. And this sequence, they're usually pretty short, and they're called the regulatory sequence because they control when and where and how much and how fast a gene should be expressed in a cell. If we think about the human being, then human being, every cell in the human being contain exactly the same copy of a genome. However, we have different cells. We have neuron cells in the brain, have muscle cells in your body. Because the muscle cell is a muscle cell and neuron cell is a neuron cell because they express a different set of genes encoded in genome. And the function to and the function of the regulatory sequence is to during the embryogenesis process, for example, is to tell which cell will express which set of genes and become a neuron cell or a nervous cell or a muscle cell. So so this is called gene regulation. So the weight for to achieve the gene regulation is for the regulatory sequences is they interact with a specific kind of a protein called transcription factors. So the interaction of transcription factors with these sequences will regulate the nearby gene transcription. Here's a cartoon showing in the case for the bacteria, for example, E. coli, and we see you have three genes. They make a tandem arrangement in the genome, and this is usually called an operon because they share the same regulatory sequences to control the transcription of these genes. So what happens is this enzyme called the RNA polymerase, which will use DNA as a template and synthesize a messenger RNA. But the happening is the RNA polymerase contain a few subunits. One is called the sigma subunit, which bind into a specific site, and then recruit the other four subunits of RNA polymerase. And for some gene, maybe this binding is enough to initiate the transcription for some housekeeping genes. These genes that exist in every cell, they're required by every type of cell, so they do not contribute to the specificity of cell. But for other types of genes, the transcription of these genes requires the interaction of these transcription factor binding sites with these regulatory sequences and initiate the transcription process. So the RNA polymerase go through the DNA, read through DNA and generate the messenger RNA, and messenger RNA will be used as template to synthesize a protein. So these regulatory sites is also called the transcription factor binding site. So they're almost equally important as the protein encoding or RNA encoding genes. However, to study them experimentally and computationally it's more difficult because they're very short. So we already see the other slides talking about how the sequence technology will revolutionize the biology research because the cost of a drop and the problem that the CPU time cannot catch up that increase. And again, I'll show you the different view of slide, but unfortunately, I cannot get the update. I'm going to get one from back to 2009. However, these figures all get by the two days ago. And you can see since the first genome sequence in 2009, and in particular since the new generation sequence technology become available on the market, the number of genome has been sequenced, increased exponentially. And here I just list a few, a database, the document or the register project or the genomes that have been sequenced. And you see, as of today, we already have about For the bacterial, we already have about 1,500 genomes sequenced. And for the eukaryotes, and there are about 6,000 genomes in the pipeline. And recently, the Beijing Genome Research Institute, they announced to sequence 10,000 genomes. And the DOE and NSF and USDA just made an announcement. They're going to sequence about 20,000 bacterial genomes. They call the geobiome. It's how to sequence every possible species or dominant sequence on the Earth, exists everywhere. So knowing the sequence, just like we have a book which specifies the life. However, we do not know how these things are organized together and really achieve a life. So, and obviously, it's not possible to experimentally characterize all these organisms. And maybe it's not necessary because the evolution connected all these organisms. So ideally, we should be able to, at least someday, we can explain the functions of the cells just using the linear DNA sequence, because all the things which specify life are included in that linear sequences. So of course, there are a lot of things going on. To achieve that goal, we have to know how these elements interact with each other and how they respond to environment. But in the first step towards that goal is we have to understand the part list or the part list for the life. So I would think the part list can be seen as two types. One is the genes. I just said the gene, the coding sequence. Another is the rectal sequence or transcription factor binding site. So computation biology has played a big role to decode the genes, to predict the genes. That's called a gene finding problem. To give you a sequence of the genome and tell me which segment specify a gene and which segment don't, which segment don't. But this problem is pretty well solved. I should not say it's 100% solved, because we still can't predict 100% of genes, but the majority gene we can reliably predict. However, to predict this rectory sequence or 25 binding site is a big problem. And recently, the importance of this sequence has been brought to attention. For example, the chimpanzee and the human being, their genome is 99.99% are the same. They all the protein coding sequences. But the human is totally different from the chimpanzee, in particular in the intelligence development. And people think that the major difference is the expression of a different kind of these genes. And a lot of disease has been associated with the mutations in these regulatory sequences. So the reason to study this, the difficult to study these sequences is, in my opinion, it's for the following reasons. One is these sequences are very short compared to the gene. Gene can be a few thousand base pair long, but this regulatory sequence, they usually like 6 to 25 base pair. And there are only four types of nucleotides in the genome. So the mere chance to have any pattern sequence happening in the genome, in human a very large genome, for example, for the human being, will have about 3 billion base pairs in the genome. So the chance to have any pattern sequence happen is high. So that's one reason. Another reason is, these sequences, they are seated in a very much larger background sequence. I said they are short, but they're seated in, basically in bacteria, we know they are in the gene sequence, but in the gene sequence is like 1,000 nucleotides long, and the binding site is only a few nucleotide base. So it's very difficult to locate them. And another reason is there's no pattern for these sequences. Any binding site, any sequence can be binding site as long as there's some protein which has a 3D structure combining to it. Here, I give you a few examples for the binding site. Here's the sigma factor binding site, which is a component in RNA polymerase, which mobilizes RNA polymerase to the promoter range and has this type of sequence. And you see some column is relatively conserved, but some column are free to mutate. And here's another binding site in E. coli, which specify how the bacteria should use glucose. When the glucose appear, some gene will be expressed and utilize glucose. And you can see this binding site here. We can compute the channel entropy for each column and use information contents to use a Lego to represent it. So the higher the letter means that that letter when the nucleotide is more conserved than the other ones. And you can see this CRP protein, CRP is a transcription factor binding, a transcription factor in E. coli. You see, it recognizes three different motifs. Because we call that the binding site, all the binding sites recognized by a same transcription factor called a motif. So how we can predict the motifs? Because I just said that any segment sequence can be a binding site. So usually the binding sites are predicted by compare a set of sequences and see potentially each of the sequences contain a binding site. So we are looking for a highly conserved or highly overrepresented chema in this sequence compared to a background model. So currently, this is called a motif finding problem. A lot of algorithms have been developed to solve this problem. However, the performance is not far more satisfactory because the issue I just mentioned, the a few causes for the difficult for prediction. As just said, that to predict the binding site, we have to know a set of sequence that contain binding site. And usually these set of sequence are in traditional way is acquired through experimental research. But the genome project give us a very good chance to get a set of sequence that can potentially contain the binding site. This is due to the evolutionary reason. Because from the biological research, we know that in many cases, not only the gene are conserved, but also the regulatory sequence or binding site also can conserved. So, the sequence project pose a big challenge for us to analyze it, but they also give us a big chance to solve some biological problem. For example, transcription factor binding site prediction, which is not really possible before. The reason is we can basically give a genome, for example, we can target the genome T, and we look at each gene in that genome, and we look at all the other orthologous genes of that gene in the other genomes. Orthologous gene here means the gene which has the same function, but they're evolutionarily related to each other, but they're located in the different species. For example, the gene in our body to break down the glucose as orthologous to the gene in E. coli, which break down the glucose, because we both can use glucose. And we can extract these sequences, and we're pretty sure because the gene, for example, here the gene which break down the glucose from species 1, species 2, we know they are the gene to break the glucose, and we just extract the in the gene sequence and do motif finding and identify the most conserved segment of sequence. And we can, but this can only predict binding site for one gene. Remember, our goal is to predict the binding site in the genome scale for each gene. So one intuitive way is probably we can do this for all the other genes, and then cluster the similar sequence together, and then we say, okay, here's all the sequence in this genome, which is recognized by that transcription factor. However, this approach doesn't work very well. So we recently developed an algorithm to further improve the prediction. So we first predict the operons by using multiple information. For example, we first do the homologous prediction do by sequence comparison, and then look at the multiple genomes. Here I only show the three genomes. Each line in this graph shows one genome and make a connection if there's a homologous gene exist or orthologous gene exist in other genome. And then we look at the conservativeness of this gene pairs, because operons tend to conserve in the different genomes. And then we use the other three pieces of info, the other four pieces of information, and then train a neural network. And then for each adjacent gene, we differentiate them into a operon pair or non-operon pair. And after the, because do this is very important. After we put it operon, we know which sequence we can look for the binding site, because the binding site will not exist in the two genes in the gene sequence between the two genes that are in the same operon. So we predict operon will guide us where we should look for binding site. And after this, then we have to select a group of genes, because right now we have 6,000 genomes. And for the prediction of binding site in a specific genome, we have to look at which genome we should use as a reference genome. So they're close enough, but they are also divergent enough. If they're exactly the same, then we cannot predict. We want to allow them to have some deviation, but they should not be too far away. And we can construct a phylogenetic tree which relates the which describes the evolution relationship or the gene regulatory network of these genes of the genomes, and then we can select a group of these genes for the prediction, and then we further predict the a group of operons, we think that they are they're homologous or they're orthologous to each other, and then we extract their sequences for each group. Here I show you three genomes, but usually we use as many genomes as possible, and we extract many of these in the gene sequence. Each of these set associated with a set of genes. These genes, they are functionally related to each other. So that means they are they will be similarly regulated. That means their upstream in the gene sequence will potentially contain the binding site. And after we have this, for example, when we try to predict the binding site in E. coli, we use a 32 gamma protein bacterial genome, which E. coli belongs to, and do analysis. And we identify 4,000 such in the gene sequence set. And then we look at all the possible overrepresented chemas in this sequence set, because we do not know which chema, conserved chema, is binding site. Because the difficulty is that the conserved site may not necessarily a binding site. In some cases, usually it's true, conserved site is binding, but sometimes it's not compared to background. So we wanted to here just show you that each of these slides means one set of indigenous sequence, represented by I1 all the way to IM. In the E. coli case, I'm sure we have about 4,000 of these sequence set. And then for each of these things set, we use different strategies to identify all possible overrepresented chemas. But that means our goal is to harvest as many as possible true binding site. But of course, during this process, we're going to also introduce a lot of spurious predictions. So we need to, through evaluation, we know we harvest all possible no binding, but we also include a lot of false positives. So the algorithm is designed to try to fill out these spurious predictions and keep the true binding site. So the idea we have is we make for each of these motifs, we predict from for each of the indigenous sequence. For example, each of these triangles represents one set of indigenous sequence, and one dot represents one motif we identified as a overrepresented chema. And then we make a connection between these nodes using the similarity of this binding site as a weight. Of course, building this, we have to use a cutoff in order to avoid a fully connected graph, which you cannot do anything. And then we have two assumptions. One assumption is that a true motif is more likely being identified by different strategies. So you have connections among them in one of this rectangle. And another is usually a 120 factor regulate multiple genes. So we should have a similar binding site appear in the other in the gene sequences. So we have a connection in this horizontal fashion. So then we can model this problem, the binding site finding problem, as a graph problem. Specifically, we want to find a highly condensed subgraphs in this big graph. The highly condensed, that means they have the vertical connection because they're identified by different strategies, and they have a highly connected in horizontal fashion. That means they have multiple occurrence of a similar site in the genome. In other words, a spurious one, the chance for it to have in multiple places in the genome should be lower. And then we devise a graph-based algorithm to do that. So the first is, so we calculate the similarity between all the possible pairing of the motif we identify for this 4,000 in the gene sequence set. And then we consult the two graphs because we're using two different cutoff. The reason is we want to use a high cutoff, so the graph has low density, so the algorithm can work well on it. And the another one has a slightly high density, so we can keep the weak binding site still in the graph. And then we work on the low density graph using a Markov chain-based algorithm to cut them into small pieces. And then we project them into the graph we consulted with a low cutoff, so a low similarity cutoff, so it has a high density. So the key issue is that the red ones is not included in the G2. And then we make a new connection between these ones and then do this MCL cut again. And we generate the clusters, and then we project them back into the high density graph and generate the independent components. And then for each of these subgraph or independent components, we do clique finding to find, for each node, we find a clique associated with it. In other words, we find the maximal clique associated with for each node. And then, so the clique means that this graph is highly connected. It's a dense graph. It's potentially a binding site. But it seems this criteria is too strict because some binding sites, they may not be very similar to each other in the fashion we define. So we relax the condition a little bit and merge them. And then we do the motif finding again. So in this stage, when we do motif, because the information has been enriched, so the motif finding become much easier. So we can identify basically majority of the two binding sites. And then we rank these motifs according to the quality using this formula. And you can say the high rank, that means the high quality of the predicted binding sites. And the different colors in this sequence means the sequence from different genomes. And then the last step is to merge the sequence according to the source of genome. Then we predict the binding site in a group of genomes. So this algorithm has been performed very well. For this project, we got funded from NSF. But we recognize that this algorithm is not cannot deal with tens of thousand genomes. So we have to go parallel. So the first step we have twice. We try to parallelize this the algorithm on a local university cluster. We have about 300 CPUs. So I just mentioned that these algorithms are made by a few steps. So for the first part is to, giving you, for example, right now we have, if we go to NCBI, we have 1,500 genomes. So we download all these databases and we construct, we predict the operons. We can do this by embarrassed parallel programming. And then we construct a tree and then we divide them into multiple groups. in these groups, they are evolutionally close enough to have the binding site conserved, but they are divergent enough that we can differentiate they are, which ones conserved, which ones not conserved. And then we predict the operons, and then we extract the indigenous sequence, and all this can be done parallel computation. And then we predict we identify the over-replicaments. This can be also is a inversely parallel a problem. And then, but the computer, the similarity score is not, because we are doing this pairwise comparison. So if we do inverse parallel programming, then it turns out it will end up multiple nodes will read the same file. So we have strategy. One is to duplicate the files. But the file turns out very large, so it's not practical in our case, in a local cluster. So what we do is we do to solve this I/O bottleneck, we do the divide and conquer approach to each of the nodes read equal parts of the file, and then the broadcaster to the rest of the nodes. So they have a pushing of motifs. They need to compute the similarity with the rest of all the other profiles. In other words, each node contains a full copy of the motifs we predict, and then we do they will construct the graph. And the color graph, this is a Markov chain based algorithm. It's very fast. So right now we don't do parallelization. And it seems parallelizing is also more difficult because it considers all the possible connections, a lot of inter node communications. And then another step is to find that this is quasi clicks. The problem is to find these clicks. Remember that the algorithm cut the big graph into multiple subgraphs. It turns out some graphs are very big, some graphs are very small. So if we do parallel programming, then the larger ones need to work. If we assign a logic subgraph to one node, that would take that node for one day to compute. And for the other ones, they can take maybe a few minutes to finish. So the approach we solve this is by using the master and slave model, so that the master keep the nodes that has been found for click, and the list which has not. So it will start with the small subgraphs and submit them to the for the slaves for computing. And when the slave finish, they will ask for another job and send it. Until we deal with the bigger ones, then they will split the job to the different nodes. So I'm going to finish. So we haven't really done anything serious by putting this algorithm on the edge yet, but we did some investigation. And I think a few steps can be easily adapted to the edge platform. For example, before I came here, I'm not aware the MPI is also available right now in the Asia, because I read the original documentation says it's not available. Only parallel, embarrassingly, parallel computing is available. So we think that. But so I think right now it's possible to adapt our MPI code to the new version of Asia. And we also consider the Hadoop and the map reduce, because I heard a lot about this, and see if we can compare all these parallel environment and see which one perform best. And this project is the part of the Greek club development is done by my postdocs and my graduate students. And the MPI parallelization is in collaboration with Barry Wilkinson and his graduate student, Riddick Dura. And our NSF funded and Microsoft supported the project to put the algorithm on the edge. I collaborated with Srinivas and his graduate student, Yuji Zhou. And Srinivas is in the audience. And thank you very much. I'm ready to take the questions.
Great, there's no questions. Well, thank you, Dr. Su. Appreciate it.
What's the name of your project?
The city project.
The city project.
Like in city project. City.
All right, our final presenter this afternoon is Dr. Barak Fishbain from the University of Southern California, from my own home turf, at least in the old days. And he's going to talk about the U.S. City Project, which involves clever transportation, which you need in Southern California.
Definitely. Good afternoon. I'm Barak, and I'm the only thing that keeps you from your dinner. I'll be exploiting this time to talk about a project that we're doing down at USC and is dealing actually in traffic data management. And we thought if a bank can do it, we can play with the word city as well. So we call it the City Project, meaning clever transportation. So what is the motivation? Basically, we, and it was said here many times, that data may shed light on many fundamental questions. And now if I ask you or if I ask any researcher in transportation, human behavior, engineering, what drives the driver? What is the motivation or what the utility function? What the driver tries to minimize or maximize when he drives? The answer is not known. And we believe that part of the reason that this answer is not known is there is no data. So what do you mean there is no data? Of course, there is data out there. Just, you know, there are loop detectors, there are cameras, there are police reports, there are all this sort of stuff. How come there is no data? Because nobody has bothered to store this data, and for a good reason. So basically what we're trying to do is we're trying to develop three new branches of science. And the first one we called road psychology. Basically, is we would like to look at how roads behave in different situations. Now, I dare you, you give a call to your DOT office, close to your home, and ask them to shut down a highway because you want to check how the traffic behaves when this highway is blocked. Now, of course, you know, in the better case, the phone will be hanged on you, or in the worst case, you'll be arrested. The thing is that give me a highway, and without checking, I can tell you that in a very good chance, you will find an event in history when the exact situation you want to check happened. The thing is, nobody bothered to save the information. The second line of research that we try to develop is road sociology, and meaning that we want to see how roads behave between themselves. What happens if I block I-5? How does it affect 405? And funny enough, this example is good here as well as good in LA. And the last one is road epidemiology. Now, one example, and I don't like this example because it has some negative connotations, but transportation system breakdown at Michael Jackson's funeral. By the way, it didn't happen when Obama visited twice in 1 month LA, but it did happen when in Michael Jackson's funeral. Now, nobody knows why. No exceeded number of accidents, no, you know, just, you know, the system at its top capacity, and it broke down. Now, nobody knows why. And this is one of the big main questions, that open big question there, which we don't know the answer because our project was not fully operated back then. So once you have the data, and I hope I managed to convince you by now that data is important, or if I, you know, the rest of the speakers didn't do it this today. So there are many questions, other questions that we want to address. The first one is, you know, how these affect traffic. You know, and it was funny enough when I tried to observe, you know, what people say about the gas prices, it seems that, you know, you can support your previous opinion by the gas prices going up or down. So it doesn't really matter if they go up or down, you will find a way to support your own opinion. But what really happens? You know, how does this affect traffic? How does it affect transit, occupancy in transit? Another example is, how do we manage pricing and congestion? How do we manage spillovers? You know, if you have a highway and the roads that, you know, ramp metering is an ingenious idea, the only problem is that it creates congestion on the streets rather than on the highway. Incident management. You know, now I have an event, and what would be the optimum way, and this corresponds to the example I just gave you, let's shut down I-5 and see what happens. And, of course, disaster and evacuation study, which is a great source of funding these days, but it's an interesting research topic as well. Now, we have user applications. So we have navigation application, which now it's crowdsourcing, and you can tell, you know, what is the situation on the highway before you're going there. Or if you want to do a car share, or you want to check if car share or carpool is an effective choice today. Okay, it's really funny to see Thanksgiving Day and carpool lanes. Okay, so the interesting thing about all these applications that every and each of the examples I gave you is managed by a different entity in the government, in the government level, by different agency. Moreover, they do not like to cooperate. Moreover, all of them are more important than the others. Okay, so basically what we want to create an environment where each can access its own data, do not allow other to access it because this is more important than the others, and his data is more secure or more important than the others' information, but still have a unified framework that deals with all the data that we collect over Southern California and allows it and expose it to the different users. So the goal basically is to acquire, and this is a major issue, but luckily it was solved for us because there is a major project, in Southern California that's going on for the last 10 years that actually collects all the data to one place, and then it puts the data together on one Ethernet cable, and then the cable lies on the floor. Nobody wants to touch it. Then we need to process, and I'll explain in a second what it means to process it, store it, but store it is not enough. We need to make the data accessible. Otherwise, why store it? So this what brought up the city project, and basically, as I said, we have data collected from police reports, transit, traffic, camera, and still cameras and video cameras. We feed everything into a Microsoft platform, and this is a morphing at this stage, but I'll explain it because this has both off and on cloud components. And then we expose this data to different applications. The first one is Metrans. It's a recent transportation center at USC that deals with urban transportation. So we give them data which they never had, and they can come with new insights which were never available. Then, of course, we have the Metro, which are our main source of funding, and it's the Los Angeles County Metropolitan Transportation Authority. And we expose the data to them just, you know, as a source of research and archive. Then, of course, real-time monitoring, and I'll show you how historical data can use for monitoring, and, of course, for historical and behavioral studies and research. You can see this is a fairly large project, and by this, I gave acknowledgement to all the partners. I don't see him here. One important component is the SQL/Stream Insight group. And there is a distinguished engineer from Microsoft by name Muhammad Ali, which helped us a lot with the architecture and some design issues. And Setu Balan, which is his boss. And they're supporting us enthusiastically. And the success of this project is due to their contributions as well. So let's talk about on and off cloud consideration. So everybody here say, like, let's put everything on the cloud. Yeah, cloud is good. Let's put everything on the cloud. So working with the cloud costs money. I know that in the universities, we don't know what money is. But this is something that in the real world, people give to someone in order to get services. And if you take a look at how much it costs, so you can see that these are the prices I extracted on December 2010 when we actually submitted a proposal. And we just want to show that how much the storage and transaction cost. Now, for the size that we are talking about in our project, just for uploading the data once and read every bit only once. Okay, otherwise there's no point of writing if you don't read it. So read once, write once, and store the data for a month. It sums up to almost $400,000. Now, when you already have the computational infrastructure on site, it's very hard to convince LA Metro to put this amount of money every month. Now, having said that, when we retrieve the data, it contains a lot of not that useful information. And there is no point to upload to the cloud. There is no point of saving faulty sensors. There is no point of saving no transportation at 3 a.m. So we need to do some pre-processing, and that's exactly how the infrastructure looks like. So basically, we get this traffic data from 8 different agencies, and of course, they do not agree on the format of the data, so we need to unify the data. And then we have transit data, which is the number of passenger, location of buses, how many tickets were sold. We have event system, which includes also CHP, which is California Highway Patrol events system, and Caltrans, California DOT, information in event system like working site and construction site, the boards, the message boards, and we feed everything into a Stream Insight server. Now, this server resides off the cloud. And what this Stream Insight server does is, first of all, it cleans the data. Whatever, we don't need faulty sensor, as I said. Then it unifies it, because again, the data is not unified when we get it. And finally, it represents the data in a convenient way that we can store it. Now, this is something that was omitted or not addressed specifically in Professor Franklin's presentation, and we believe this is a key component. So you can represent the data in a better way than you get it. So this is, it's not compression, because if you compress the data, you kind of lose all query capabilities. But you do represent the data in a way that is more efficiently and compactly represented. So once, and I tried to create a presentation which doesn't have the cloud sketch, so I use this one. And basically, once we clean, we unify, and we represent the data, we upload it to the cloud. Now, in the cloud, we have four components. So first of all, we save it to Azure tables. Okay, we have to remember that, again, this is due to financial reasons. Azure tables are way less expensive than Azure SQL. So we wouldn't like to save it to a SQL server. We save it to Azure table. Now, the reason that we hold these tables is because the customer, LA Metro, they do not know what they want to do with the data. You just save it. But tell me what you need, and I'll save what you know, what you actually need. Save everything. You never know. So that's why we put everything on Azure table. Then we have a Stream Insight on the cloud. And this is very similar to the presentation we saw earlier about the stock buying selling mechanism. The Stream Insight, and actually I was quite amazed because they described the Stream Insight server without knowing about Stream Insight, which I think is quite clever. But we have now Stream Insight clever on this on cloud. Now, the reason that we have this one on the cloud, because it takes the raw data, so to speak, on the Azure tables, and it puts it, it generates the pattern. Now, we do generate some patterns, some summaries, some sketches of the data, and then we save it to a SQL Azure. So we don't save the data as is. We do some processing, but note that we do all the processing on the cloud because there is no point of downloading the data and upload the sketches, and by this, we save the transactions fee. So basically, this is the architecture. And now I'll show you a little bit of the research that behind this simple architecture. So the first one I'll address is how we generate the patterns. Now, intuitively, I assume that you will all agree that data is redundant. Okay, what you see here are two consecutive Mondays. You can see that, and this is the average speed at a certain location, and from 6 a.m. to 9 p.m., and you can see that the data is fairly the same. I can tell you furthermore, if you come to a transportation research, it will tell you it is exactly the same. They are not mathematicians, so they don't care, you know, about these small fluctuations. Okay? Now, what you see here is the same, location, is the three locations, three adjacent locations, and you can see the speeds. And again, a transportation researcher will tell you these are exactly the same. Now, this makes sense, you know, unless you blow up. If you have one car at a certain location, it should appear at the following sensor in a short amount of time. So basically, what we're trying to do, we're trying to exploit these two to represent the data in a compactly and efficiently way. Now, this means that compactly, we would like to save storage space, but we cannot compress the data. Usually, if you go to information theory, if you compress the data, you increase the entropy. Basically, you lose some of the query capabilities that you have when the data is very redundant. Okay, for one example, you squeeze the data into one specific location, which might very small bytes. So if you want to, for example, to look on a specific information, you need first to extract it. And then efficiently, so this means that we need to find a way to do it so the data is still queryable. This is the first method we came with, and this is fairly easy. We have the average, we have the patterns, remember? Let's use those. And again, I told you, if you go to the transportation research, I will tell you there is no different. Okay, as long as there is no different, we'll just say it's the pattern. As soon as I deviate, or as soon as the data deviates from the pattern, I'll save the original data. In this way, I can set up the thresholds, and basically I can set the error bounds, and I can tell you in advance what is the maximum error that that I allow. And what you see here is just the error in percent and how the compression of the data increases. Now, this is fairly an efficient way. We keep the data in the signal domain rather than moving to a transformation domain. So we save on query time, but it's fairly trivial. So this is the first thing that we did to do. And we have some other research that we're doing right now that actually looks at more transportation network flow theory and try to use tools from there in order to represent the data. Another thing that you can do once you have the pattern, now think of it, for every segment, for every road link, you have the time over the average speed over the day, right? Basically, what you have here for every link is some kind of a temporal weighing function, meaning now the weights on the graph change over time, and now I can come up with time-dependent shortest path, not just the shortest path as every navigation software would give you. Now it's time-dependent. Now in LA, I can show you an example. If you leave LA International Airport and you go north on 405, the same 405, and you reach I-10, if you arrive in 20 minutes difference, the change can be from 10 minutes to go east to a certain to USC, for example, to an hour and 10 minutes. So the change can be significant, And that's there's a great question when you leave the origin and when you arrive the next link. So this is another line of research that that we did. And what you see here actually is the time dependent. Now, I'm using Google Maps for a reason, OK? What you see here in green is Google Maps route, the suggested route. OK, what you see here is our route, which changes over time. OK, so since it's a bad thing, I use Google. Now, by the way, it's the same case with Microsoft Bing. What you see here, on the other hand, is monitoring application. And what you see here is a sensor. And I can see, you can see here, you can hardly see the noting, but this is east-west, and this is to the east, and this is to the west. And what you see in red is the template. What you see in blue is what is happening right now. So I can generate a mechanism that if this traffic deviates from the traditional, from the pattern, I can generate an alert. I can send someone out. I can change the traffic lights. I can change the billboards to try to mitigate the effect before it really happens, because I have some kind of indication. Now, the extension of this research is to generate patterns of escalating events. So these are just the two of the researchers that research lines that we pursue. Finally, and this is something that we're really proud of, what you see is a fast forward. You have to every sensor, and this is what you see here is a sensor. Every sensor gives its a reading every minute. This is something inherent in the system. We cannot go any faster than a minute. Just to give you numbers, every minute we get 40 megabytes of data. Okay, this corresponds to 5 megabits per second, which is fairly a large stream or a big stream of data that we have to deal. Stream Insight does it. We have no worries. We don't need to. We are not afraid there. In the worst case, we can scale up with adding more Stream Insight server. To this end, it's really easy. So what you see here, basically, the numbers are the recorded speed every minute. The color corresponds to the service level you get. And the round ones are the highway. This is I-10, the semi-10. USC is somewhere around here. And this is our street surface. Now, this is one of the applications that mayors would kill to have. They can't. Why? Because in this case, you can see how the traffic on the highway, which is the responsibility of the county of the state, affect the street, which is the responsibility of the mayor. The mayor would love to close all these exits and, you know, you do it somewhere else. I don't need the highway traffic in my streets. Now, this regional monitoring is not available in any of the transportation data systems today. There is PEMS, P-E-M-S, that was written in Berkeley. What you can do in this system, you can look on the highway. You cannot look on the streets, but even if you could, then you couldn't do the integration. What you see here basically is a visualization of just a section of the Azure table that we plot again. And then you can see how the traffic here affect the traffic here, and you can do regional monitoring. Another thing that we produce and is not shown here is that we can do, as soon as you zoom in on a region or you zoom out on a region, we give you the plot for the last hour and the last 24 hours. This is just an aggregated query on the data. Now you understand why it has to be fast. Now, you know, if you take the entire LA region, which is around 6,000 sensors, you cannot do the aggregated query every time the user zoom in or zoom out. So you need to find a mechanism to do it as well. Basically, this is what all I wanted to tell you and show you today. If you have any question, I would be happy to take them.
Correlate a specific sensor on one street to, like, because there are, can be many, many dependencies and inputs and outputs to the stream. You're saying you can see how one sensor can influence the traffic, but there are so many inputs. It's like dynamic programming.
Well, we don't use models here, and this is where we more similar to what I started with, psychology and sociology. We observe behavior, which is easier. Actually, up to this day, I just read a paper that was published 2 months ago in Transportation Research Records B, that the Gonzo from Berkeley is fighting with some other professor in Germany what causing a specific behavior. We don't want to go there. I'm not a transportation researcher, even though the CS people say I'm the best person in, I'm the best CS person in transportation, and the transportation people say I'm the best transportation person in CS. But I don't want to go there. I just give you the data, and you provide the analysis. And here, you know, they try to do correlation, but the data so knows it, so correlation is out of the question. Basically, they look on averages, but a long-term averages, and they try to infer, you know, the connections. But basically, what I want to do, just give you the information, and then you can take it and do whatever you want with it.
My question is on the cost of Windows Azure related components that you had after the refactoring was done. Did the cost come down from the 400,000 figure, or is it still the same?
Significantly. The compression rate we have right now is, so basically we estimated about 15 terabytes a year of data. After representation of the data and cleaning it, now we are standing on 2. So right away, you have a factor of 7.5. Now, this year, we invested mainly in bringing the system together. So every minute that I talk, you know, 26 minutes of data were saved on the cloud while I was talking. So the main efforts were putting on that, and we used very, as I showed you, very simplistic representation method. We have some more sophisticated method in our queue. Some of them we already have the results and we are very happy with, and then we are talking about 1 to 10 and 1 to 15. So at least in storage and transaction, you can cut immediately.
Ricardo Jiménez, Universidad Politécnica de Madrid. So this stream processing is done in real time, or is something that you do as batch processing? Is based on persistent data?
So for every minute that we get the data, we process it and we save it. Otherwise, you won't be able to accommodate for the processing the stream. So you have to stay in real time. What we do, however, the patterns we generate every day overnight. And it takes about 2 hours upper limit. So if you remember the architecture, so we save the data to Azure table, and this we do every minute. And the cleaning and the processing and the data representation we do every minute. And basically, it's not a big deal, because if you think of it, any video codec will give you data compression real time 25 frames per second. So this is not an issue with processing computational power. To generate the patterns that we save to Azure SQL on the cloud, this is something that we do every night, and it takes up to 2 hours. And the reason that we do it overnight and we wait in data for the entire day, if you want to generate a pattern, you need to accumulate some information. So there's no point of doing it every minute, especially when, you know, the patterns do not change in this updating process that much. Sometimes they don't even change at all.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Fishbain. We appreciate your participation. And I think we're going to call this session, unless we had one more question. Did we have one more question? Okay, let's make it quick. The other session's out, and they're going to be jumping on the bus.
Okay, sorry. Sorry to hold everyone. Last question of the day. So I understand your optimization is based basically on price, right? The reduction of the data is dictated by the price of storage in Azure, right? If it was cheaper, you wouldn't do it if you could store everything there. Now, this morning in the talks, we've seen that storage and its cost is actually getting cheaper by a faster factor than compute. So maybe this is going to go away in 1, 2, or 3 years. So does it really make sense to focus on such optimizations in principle?
That's a valid question. First of all, the straightforward answer, yes, we generate papers. To take it more seriously, no matter how you increase the data size, eventually you will reach to the point where you miss this one byte. So now you think about LA, but if you want to implement this on a Microsoft level, Bing Maps, so this is something that becomes worldwide, there is an efficiency. Now, even if we take it one step further, if you download one byte from the network, if you download 100 bytes from the network, there is a time difference. And no matter, doesn't really matter. So if you keep the data in a compressed format, so to speak, it's not really compressed format, then downloading it in a compressed format will prove itself, especially, again, when we keep the compression in the signal domain. So basically, when I say compression, I mean that I give you an approximate of the data, which is, in this case, it can be something that, can be imitate JPEG. And since this is my background, I speak a lot of codecs and image compression. This is how you can look at it, and then, okay, I'll give you the estimate, but if you want more, then let the data come down to you, and then refine the information you have. So basically, price is one thing, and it was the motivation for our sponsor, but we see these two other features fairly important to keep the compression research going on.
Okay, thank you very much, Dr. Fishbain. And